New York, everyone, here is a look now at the tournament brackets from the NCAA and its corporate champions as we reveal the fourth and final bracket, the Southeast region. These are second and third round games to be played Thursday and Saturday in Washington, D.C. And the number one seed in the Southeast region, the Pitt Panthers, the 10th team out of the Big East. Panthers won the Big East regular season title with 15 conference wins. They will play the first round winner of the game to be played Tuesday in Dayton between UNC Asheville, the Bulldogs, back to the NCAA tournament after an eight-year absence, and Arkansas Little Rock, the Trojans, their first NCAA tournament appearance since 1990. Out of the Horizon League, last year's finalist, the Butler Bulldogs, coached by Brad Stevens, making his fourth straight NCAA tournament appearance. The Butler Bulldogs, 23-9 on the year and 13-5 in the Horizon League. They will play Old Dominion, the Monarchs from the Colonial Athletic Association. They won the tournament title, knocking off VCU. Meanwhile, second and third round games, Thursday and Saturday in Tucson, Arizona. You caught a glimpse of them. The fifth team out of the Big 12, the Wildcats of Kansas State, coached by Frank Martin. Four straight 20-win seasons at Kansas State. They are 22-10 on the season, and congratulations to the Deep Purple. Who will they take on? They'll take on the Aggies of Utah State out of the Western Athletic Conference, regular season school record with 28 wins. Utah State won the WAC tournament championship, and there they are. Meanwhile, the sixth team out of the Big Ten, and in the Southeast region, the Wisconsin Badgers. Coach Bo Ryan, 10 seasons at Wisconsin, 10 NCAA tournament appearances. They will take on, out of the Atlantic Sun, the Belmont Bruins, who won their fourth regular season Atlantic Sun title in the last 6 years. They'll sit around and applaud and then begin to think about the Wisconsin Badgers. So that's the top half of the Southeast region. Let's move now to the bottom half. Second and third round games to be played Thursday and Saturday in Tampa, Florida. The fifth team out of the SEC, the Florida Gators, coached by Billy Donovan, went to the SEC tournament finals before losing to Kentucky. They will meet out of the Big West, the Gauchos of UC Santa Barbara, the Gauchos back-to-back Big West tournament championships. The seventh team out of the Big Ten, the Spartans of Michigan State. Coach Tom Izzo makes it 14 straight NCAA tournament appearances. They will take on the UCLA Bruins, the fourth team out of the Pac-10. The Bruins have won 11 national championships. Second and third round games to be played Thursday and Saturday in Denver, Colorado, out of the Mountain West. The Cougars of BYU, they share the Mountain West regular season title with San Diego State. They have Mountain West Player of the Year, Jimmer Fredette, who leads the nation in scoring. Who do they play? From the Southern Conference, the Terriers of Wofford, who won their second straight Southern Conference tournament title. They enter the tournament on an eight-game winning streak. And the 11th team out of the Big East, the Red Storm of St. John's. Coach Steve Lavin in his first season at St. John's. Better late than never, guys. The Red Storm into the tournament for the first time since 2002. And they will take on, out of the West Coast Conference, the Bulldogs of Gonzaga. Coach Mark Few makes it 12 straight NCAA tournament appearances with the Bulldog, 11 straight regular season WCC titles. So as we look back at the Southeast region, Seth and Charles, what do you see?
I think this is the easiest region for Pittsburgh right here. They got some pretty good teams here, but Pitt is by far and away the class of this region.
You know what I don't see is Colorado. I mean, that is shocks me that Colorado's not in this tournament. Virginia Tech has a little bit of an argument as well, given some of the teams that went in. Let me disagree with you. I'm going guns blazing here, losing my mind a little bit. Old Dominion, Utah State, and Belmont are all going to pull off big upsets. I just think Old Dominion's a great matchup for Pittsburgh. I love the Panthers. I think Belmont runs it, and Utah State is a very veteran team. And speaking of veteran teams, how about St. John's? I like them to beat BYU in the second round. I was a little bit surprised to see BYU on the three line without Brandon Davies. I think maybe Florida eventually gets to the Final Four. But you're going to see a lot of upsets, Charles, in the top half of that region.
Well, we can disagree. I actually like BYU better. I think they've been consistent throughout the season. They got the bad break with the kid getting suspended, and I wish him the best. But they're tough. And I like their team. They got beat by San Diego State, but these teams down here are not dominant. I've already told you what I think of the Big East and St. John's. UCLA is an up-and-coming team for the future. And Florida, I think, is a little bit overrated because the SEC, top to bottom, is not that good.
There's going to be a lot of conversation about these bubble teams. That's really going to dominate the next
Well, game. as much conversation as there is about the teams that make it are the teams that don't make it. You mentioned Colorado. Who else isn't there, Greg? It surprises you.
Well, Seth made the point about Virginia Tech. That's a team that I thought had a real good argument to maybe get in. And to me, that's still a little bit surprising. Alabama as well.
How about those first four games?
First four games are pretty interesting. Again, if you have VCU and Clemson and UAB, you're talking about, you know, VCU is a team that lost seven games inside their conference. You know, Virginia Tech loses eight in the ACC. I mean, Colorado beat Kansas State three times. I don't know what else you need to do to get into the NCAA tournament.
And I like the fact that UAB, again, they got rewarded for winning Conference USA. That tells me also they have a little bit better perspective. The committee of Conference USA starting to give them some confidence.
Those first round games will be on True TV, 6 o'clock Eastern time, on Tuesday and Wednesday. The Sweet 16, the top four seeds by region, are these as you would have drawn them up? Again, we look to see if there are any shockers in there, any surprises.
Well, there's shockers all the time because I think the parity is so close. I think the difference between winning and losing a lot of times is size. If you don't have the size and athleticism to match up, but there are that many teams in the country that could say we're so much bigger and so much more athletic as in years past.
Florida is not a number two seed, in my opinion. They're not a number two seed.
All right, we talked about how many bids each conference was going to get. Predicted 11 out of the Big East, 4 from the Pac-10, 3 from the Atlantic 10, and the Big Ten got 7 teams into the tournament.
About what we expected, the first time we've ever had a conference with more than 8. Big East gets 11. There were no surprises there. You have Georgia getting in over Alabama and the SEC. Not really a surprise, but certainly a point of interest.
Power conferences against non-power conferences?
I think the real interesting one is the fact that the Colonial did get 3 in. You know, there was a lot of speculation as to whether or not VCU would find themselves in the tournament. They end up getting in. Again, I always find it interesting how the committee ultimately comes to the determination of who gets in and who doesn't.
How are you feeling about the 7 non-power conference teams?
That doesn't bother me at all, but I do have a problem with the Alabama situation. They had basically the same regular season record as Georgia, and they beat them twice head-to-head. All head-to-head would be my number one criteria when I'm trying to decide. But Georgia got in easily.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It's easier too, Greg, when you play against teams that are already ranked and you lose against them. I think they don't hold that against you. And I think that's the problem with non-power conferences. You don't get the opportunity day in and day out to play those ranked teams.
You talk about Virginia Tech, you know, their win coming at home over Duke. Clemson's best win was at home over Virginia Tech. I mean, I think they had a better profile. But Colorado, to me, it kind of reminds me of what happened to Syracuse a couple years ago, if you remember. Nobody even thought about Syracuse that year as being a bubble team. They didn't get in. I didn't even realize that Colorado was out until we saw a shot of them watching, because I didn't even think of them really as a bubble team.
Well, you know, but a lot of these teams won't play these non-power conferences unless they come to them. These big schools don't want to go on the road to St. Mary's and things like that. And they're at a disadvantage in that situation.
You know what, that's a good point. But I tell you one guy, if you're Seth Greenberg, you got to figure out a way to get a little bit more quality in your scheduling, non-ACC.
Yeah, but listen, Greg.
Because that's you can play in the holiday tournaments. And those give you an opportunity on a neutral court to get wins early in the season, because we put a lot of weight on the latter part of the season. I think the committee, and that's probably what hurt Colorado, was what happened to them early in the season. They were not nearly as effective. They did have a solid conference.
And their non-conference strength of schedule, Colorado, was 325.
So I do want to be fair
that they didn't do that.
As we're talking about teams that didn't make the tournament, I want to ask you, did you have St. Mary's in before all this?
I had them out. And again, we've always said, if you're a bubble team and you're left out, you've kind of put the games in the hand of the officials. Virginia Tech got left out of this tournament when they lost at home to Boston College. They needed to respond better. If they had won that game, it wouldn't even be questioned. Exactly.
They lost 2 games at home after they bit the big upset of Duke.
Meanwhile, the teams that made it in, there are some teams that expected to be, and others, you know, again, there were some that just totally shocked us today.
Well, I think a lot of people shocked us, but I think the one thing, if you keep looking at the overall picture, when you say you're on the bubble, there is no clear difference between you and the other team that didn't get in. So I think when you look at the last teams that get in, like Clemson, USC, and Marquette, teams like that, you could say you could put them on that bubble because their RPI ranking is not that much different from those other teams. So it does come down to who you played in the non-conference schedule.
And let me tell you, let me make one thing perfectly clear about Georgia. I thought Georgia should have been in because everybody had them last four in. But nobody had them as a 10. Nobody had them as a 10.
True. It's absolutely true.
All right, guys, as we continue to take a look at the review of the brackets, this is Southeast Region and Pittsburgh. Now, what do you think about Pittsburgh and their potential trip through the tournament?
You know what? Everybody's saying it. Well, I shouldn't say it. A lot of people think maybe they have an easy. I think Kansas State is the team you got to worry about if you pick. I think Kansas State, they physically match up well, and they have a great guard in Jacob Pullum, and I think they have gotten over that midseason doldrum that Coach Martin had talked about. That's a very dangerous team, a potential Final Four team for me.
There are a couple of physical teams in that part of the bracket, mm-hmm. by the way. When you look at Utah State, they're a big, strong, old, physical team. Kansas State, Butler, and Old Dominion. Pittsburgh, I think, has a difficult road.
All right, guys. Coming up, Jim Nance and Clark Kellogg will talk live with Gene Smith, the man who oversaw the selection process. Plus, our experts will share some predictions that may help you fill out those brackets. And we continue on CBS in just a moment.